Hello everyone, this is Grandmaster Al Shermolinsky here in St. Louis Chess Club doing my Grandmaster in Residence thing. And today, though I'm completing the first week of my residency, and finally it's time for prepare like a pro. Now, there are different subjects, of course, that I cover, different names. This one is interesting, it's challenging to me, how to make it different from others. And just like I did last year, I would like to, rather than have it independent lectures like this week and week from now and then my last week here, I would rather make it into a three lecture series. I think we did it last time on the King's Indian defense, but anyway. So the reason I do this, because as much as I would like to show you examples of one game where I had this brilliant preparation of guessing all the moves and then just playing them over the board and winning the game without trying very hard. I don't think that thing ever happened to me, and I played chess for quite a bit of time. In reality, preparation to the game, for me at least, always consisted of going over the last game that I had in this line and try to make some improvements based on that. Well, I mean, trying, because in fact, I was not always successful. And jumping a little bit ahead, I would say that I probably was not very successful with the entire variation, if I look back. Although, again, I would probably welcome another try, if I had it. So, let's go back some long time ago. And the game that I played in an international tournament that was held in my hometown of St. Petersburg, then Leningrad, against the Moscow master, later to become grandmaster and a member of the Russian Olympic team, Alexey Vyzhmanovin. We played quite a few times. He was a talented player, particularly known for his blitz skills. Well, now, of course, blitz skills are, they mean that the player is successful in online blitz, mostly. Back then, he could do things that not too many people could, given timeouts and all that. Very sharp player, very interesting player he was. So, and our game went into this variation of the English, which, as you can see the bishop on b4, can immediately transpose to the Nimza Indian if white moves there deep on two squares. But, white doesn't have to do it. It brings about a whole lot of considerations. For example, after bishop takes c3, which is commonly done, of course, in the Nimza Indian, would the c4 pawn necessarily be a weakness? We don't know yet, maybe not, if white can leave their pawn on d3. Would that trade on c3 help black necessarily to occupy the e4 square? The answer is also negative, for the same reason, the white pawn can go to d3. So my idea in general was to create a situation in which I would make this trade, which of course doesn't have to happen, that oftentimes black pulls the bishop back. But if it happens, make this trade less effective as compared with the Nimza Indian. I played the Nimza myself as black, and I didn't like allowing it when I had the white pieces, maybe. Thus, the move order through the English. So g3, another move, of course, big chapter opens with queen c2, but we're not going to be covering that. I will be mentioning the move queen c2 because throughout many years, as I was facing this move, bishop b4, every once in a while, I wanted to play g3, but in various stages, maybe I wasn't too happy with the positions I was getting. So I had like queen c2 move, as a backup plan. Which is not to say that I did much better after Quincy too. Maybe one problem, one reason why it was like this, because of the quality of opposition. Honestly, looking over the games that I had on this line, regardless, Quincy 2 and G3, I noticed that there are quite good players. And when you play against good players, even with best prep, particularly in variations like this, when you can't really, there's no tactics, you can't really bring it to a conclusion in your preparation. You pretty much stop when you reach a certain middle game position, which you believe you can handle well. But the true test of this will come when you face strong opposition during actual game. Well, okay. So b6, it's not the only move. Black also can go castles, followed by d5, which a lot of people prefer. But here we're dealing with this b6, so that's sort of a combo now between the potential Nimes the Indian, the Queens Indian, and all sort of things like so bishop there, bishop b7. Now the move that I liked, and I still like it, white plays the pawn to d3 right away. What is the reason to do this right away as opposed to castling first, and then playing the pawn over here. Here a black can play d5. Though they don't need to trade on c3. Well, they probably don't mind trading if they can follow with the trade on c4 and swapping off the queens and all that. Then white would certainly have weaknesses in the double c pawns. But importantly, if white plays something else, for example, they trade here. And then they can do, no, who knows what white will do. It's not a fact that black will take on c3. When the bishop is attacked with a3, maybe they'll pull back to e7 or d6. So by playing d3, I wanted to avoid this, because if black plays d5 right away, then they have to deal with this check. So they don't lose a piece, most likely. But knight going to c6 is not, it's not very desirable for black, to put it this way. It blocks the bishop, blocks the c pawn. So I thought white would have a good position here. Interestingly enough, I don't think I ever had a game where my opponents would play d5. Most of them just castled. And now there it comes, e4. In itself, the structure of white pawns is not unusual. We know, of course, the Batwinic system in the English, right? But there is one detail. Batwinic always liked to put his knight on e2. Well, granted, you know, that black pieces were in a different shape. Usually, the dark square bishop would be fianchetted on g7, and the other bishop would stay on c8. But at any rate, the knight was on e2, because often white advances their f-pawn, which is now blocked. And there are many other things. Well, they play this move. Now, well, it's very logical. So probably the most direct way of dealing with this Batwinic setup. Black just strikes in the center. Now, what to do? First thing I realized, probably even before this game, that if I trade here and push the pawn forward, this has to be the best idea for white, right? Grab some space on the king side. The pawn, of course, may be supported later with the white pawn moving to d4. Problem was this move. And when white probably plays the pawn to a3, right? They don't want to lose a piece. And then, for black is possible to take, you take the bishop, take over there, bishop takes, and now they put that knight in the middle on a very comfortable square, d5. I wasn't particularly sure about this position. There are many factors here involved. Of course, the bishop pair for white, and the pawn remains on e5, so black king has no defenders. But I felt like the white bishop was misdirected. I thought the bishop would be better off on c1, supporting this important move knight g5 at some moment. The pawn on b4 is hanging, that seemed slightly annoying. Anyway, so I thought that white should not trade and move that pawn forward immediately. Now, if you go to the same thing, you'll see the difference. I actually had a game, not immediately, much later, where my opponent went for this, which I thought was a bad idea for black. So you compare this. The presence of the pawns on c4 and e6 does not allow black to put the knight in the middle. So white has this strong looking center. In fact, I traded after a pawn for the black d pawn. It cannot be very bad. So it has to be quite good for white. But we will return to this. I'm not sure if today or maybe next week. So this is the right move, knight here. Now, what's next? Again, we think that now black will probably trade pawns on c4 and then capture on c3 and make double pawns and isolated double pawns in white's position. Well, going back to this whole issue of double pawns, well, we can refer to Aaron Nimzowitsch and his seminal work, My System, where he said that not all formations that include double pawns are necessarily weak. But he said those double pawns, they become weak once they start moving forward. Or maybe even the any pawn from the pawn formation. Like, for example, if white can... If there is no pawn on d5, right? Suppose black doesn't have this pawn. Then capture on c3 doesn't make white structure weak. In some ways you may say, oh, it's great, because I have the back c pawn controlling the d4 square. But with the trade on c4 followed by the trade on c3, then you can't argue with the fact that your pawns are weak. And the square in front of them, c5, certainly beckons the black knight. Now, white, as we expect, has his counter chances on the king side thanks to the pawn on e5. But no, I wanted to take. Now, if black takes with the pawn, then white, I suppose, goes d4. And no reason to complain at all about this position. White looks very, very good. But a stronger reply is to take with the bishop. No, having the backward d pawn doesn't scare me necessarily. There are structures such as this, we know from Queen's Gambit Accepted, from many other openings. But this, okay, not wasting any time, white wants to take on d5. Vyshmanavyan traded, and he played the move I did not expect, knight to c6. I kind of automatically assumed that black would first move the c pawn forward, then follow with the knight. Well, I started thinking, no, well, maybe not for long, this seemed obvious. I couldn't really get at what my opponent was trying to accomplish. Bring the knight around from a5 to c4. No, it's a nice looking square, but the knight from c4 doesn't really do anything. He would just sit there. In the meantime, the bishop from c1, unopposed bishop, supports this move, maybe knight g5. But I already started thinking ahead, and I thought, maybe the reason he left the pawn on c7 was because he didn't want to weaken the d6 square. So even if I do like knight d2 and then knight e4, good spot for the knight, but if I don't get knight f6 sacrifice to work, which is very questionable, what other options I have with that knight? I cannot come to d6. But this didn't really materialize, because in the game I was given no time. He played this move f6. To be honest, I didn't expect it at all. I thought that, if there is a pawn chain, then you start attacking it from the bottom of this pawn chain. Maybe my lack of experience in French structures also played a role. I realized, of course, that if I take on f6, black takes with the queen, and then white can never occupy the e5 square. There are two knights. And the threat to the knight on f3 is quite annoying. I didn't want to take. After the game, I was unhappy with what I did, and I wrote in my notes that pawn takes f6 was a better choice. But I played this. I wanted to keep the pawn on e5. So this happened. Now Vejmanavin gained the c5 square for his knight. I played rook to e1. As you can see, white's playing it cool. Good protection to the e5 pawn. Then came this. That also I didn't expect. I knew about this maneuver from the Dutch structures. But here I became very concerned that the queen can come to h5. Because I felt that my pieces on the f-file can come under attack. So I played this, expecting queen h5, and I was going to answer with this move, trade. And then, but black can play this. They threatening to take the knight. What am I going to do with that knight? I can't come back to f3 because of g5. I don't think so. I'm going to drop two minor pieces for rook. Knight e4. When I play like this, obviously I'm dropping the pawn on e5. So to me it's clear that white has no advantage, and if anything, then it's black who has the initiative. Maybe I got a little lucky that he played the conservative move h6. I recall I was already in the bailout mode. I played this move, which was reasonable. So knowing that black wouldn't want to take on d4 because it would disturb the knight on c5 and the pawn on c7 behind it. So we did this. At least I had good development. He played here. I cut this knight d5 off, didn't want to see that happening. He returned, and we reached this position. I didn't like my position at all, to be honest. I think maybe even earlier we could say that white's opening strategy did not lead to anything good. But here, look at that bishop on f4. It just sits there, no prospects. I have split pawns. On the over there on the Queen's side. I don't even know to this day if my opponent missed it, or maybe because of tournament situation, he didn't mind the draw. He played this move and I'm like, whoo, big sign of relief. I took that pawn, which of course, well, can only give white draw by perpetual check, but I was happy to take it, and draw was agreed right here. So, first try in this variation, and not a very successful one. Okay. So if I close this one, open another one. That was played near the same time. Again, to the same variation. There, b6. You know, I was really thinking that white has to be able to find some advantage in this line. I even made this short comment that it's better for black to play a different line, more like a Catalan thing, by castling and playing d5. But how to prove it? Again, d3 at this moment, e4, d5. No, this line we already saw, right? D4 is pretty strong here. Maybe even knight d5 right away, but I'm not sure. Maybe capture on b2. Either way. No, I played this again. Comes to this whole thing and knight c6. So I thought, okay, if they're going to play f6, just like Vyshmanavyan did, maybe I should leave my pawn on d3. I had this idea, of course, like, what's going to happen if I play c4? I realized, of course, it doesn't really work tactically, because in this position, black, yeah, they can take with the other knight. So what should I do? Pull this. Okay, let me close this a little. Pull the bishop back and hoping to get f4 in. So there's two knights, right? I didn't think this would work, honestly. I didn't. I mean, at very best, I can get the exchange, but I already lost the pawn. I'm not sure. So what is black going to play? Queen to d7. Problem is that the 4 is not going to work, queen d4 check. So how exactly I'm going to get this to work? I don't think this works at all. So not c4 right away, but I thought I will play my bishop to f4 first. Similar to what I did in that first game. And I was thinking, okay, I'm going to play c4. Now it's a different story. I'll force him to take on f3, and with my bishop protecting e5, I might win the exchange. But my opponent, a very experienced international master and former second to Viktor Korchnoi, he spotted it, of course. He moved the rook to b8. Well, now I have to worry about bishop takes knight, followed by a capture on e5. So I played this, protecting, and he played b5. I didn't really like those. Maybe it's correct tactically, but positionally speaking. Oh, queen takes, whatever difference does it make? He comes here. Queen g4. I mean, I have a threat of bishop h6. But it's not really a threat because of knight f5. Maybe black just plays this move. Well, it's funny how the moves that black played seemingly just defending against my threats on the long diagonal, they came very handy. That move rook to b8. The rook is in perfect place on b8. Black's active. And I mentioned already bishop there, knight f5. And I have to go back. So I went to this. Actually, now looking at this position, I think white was doing okay here. The only thing is that I played this move, queen to d3. No, it's too good to be true that my opponent will blunder into knight g5. Maybe I should have gone knight g5 immediately. Trade those bishops, no big deal. But I mean, c7 pawn still covers d6. But what white needs to do here? They need to hit the h7 pawn with the queen to threaten checkmate. Better on a diagonal to force the black g pawn to move. That would be great. Weaken the dark squares. But anyway, I had to try this. This move was off the mark. This didn't do anything. I think I focused my efforts on the wrong side of the board. This was the idea to circle around. Oh. Was my idea so bad positionally? It is hard to tell. I mean, I have this bishop in a pretty active position, pinning the black knight. So in tactics, of course, I absolutely didn't see this. How to recapture? If I take with the queen, I walk into the knight d2 fork. If I take with the bishop, he's going to take my pawn on e5. Just like that. Win the central pawn. Lucky me, I had this capture. Rook fd8. e5 is hanging. And black is going to continue with c5. Well, in retrospect, I would say that again, white totally failed to get anything going on the king side. I started thinking that maybe until I changed my thinking about how the resulting positions after the opening moves needs to be played and choose the right plan. I'm not really going anywhere with my preparation. Okay. More examples here. It's going to get even worse. So, some many years later, well, I think I don't recall any significant games in that period, in this particular line. I was playing knight f3 and then c4 very often, but somehow I think I may have switched to Qc2 and replied to this bishop to b4. By the way, there was this name for this. I don't know if it's really, that's not a bad opening. They said, poor man's Nimes are Indian. Like you don't get to play, don't get to see the white pawn on d4, it's not d2. But in fact, I think it's totally legitimate. So anyway, I played this game some years later when I far better player, firmly 2600 player, FIDE and US champion I was. But maybe I won the championship little later same year. Yeah, maybe. All right, my opponent is number one player from Lithuania. I played before, always had bad luck against him. Very sturdy player, very good defender and a quick tactical eye. So we go for the whole thing. And now I play d4. I think this move sort of shows that it's a good sign of my maturity as a player. I came to realize that all the c4 things are probably not going to work out ever. And placing the white bishop to f4, it's really not going to solve the problem. So if I am to play this position, I will play it. As is. Well, I had some hopes here. I thought the black knights were not ideally placed. The d7 knight now in particular, because the black queen occupied the f6 square, where can this knight go? And I thought I would make this trade, possibly even capture on g2 with the knight. And no, try to move my pieces out. I realized that I was a little bit behind in development. And I'm pulling my knight back to the first rank. My rooks are nowhere near ready. But anyway, now he plays this. Not bad, because clearly it's in black's best interest to recapture on d5 if the pawn. The weakness will be gone from e6. That c4 square will get support. I didn't want to trade. I played this. Now, very, very controlled, solid move. No c5, which would open up the position prematurely. This. Now we start playing this game. Give squares, get squares. I came to realize that black can actually liquidate by trading bishops on g2, followed by the move e6 to e5. That pawn forward. Looks like everything's going to be traded. And I felt some kind of, was a little uncomfortable in this x-ray. The black queen and rook had against the f2 pawn. So I played this. No, right, I physically prevent the move e5. I have more attackers. I have five. Black has four supporters. He played this. I think I... Again, I misunderstood this position. I don't know if this is really better for white, but I considered this last move that Rosenthal has played, queen to g6, sort of an indication that white was doing really, really well. So I thought, okay, let me get my pawn involved and hit that queen again. The queen was short of squares. Bad move. That is a simple reply. I don't think I would accomplish anything by playing h5, if only because black, no, I don't know exactly. They can actually play this, and now white has to trade queens and go to the same game, probably end up forked with knight f6 and lose the pawn on h5. So I took back, and then my pawn never went to h5. So I played this and that. Spotted yet another tactical threat. If I blink, I lose. No. I spotted some other threat. No, this one wasn't working. Never mind. Sorry about that. There's some other line. Yeah, I don't know. I played this because. Oh, the threat was to take, of course, on f4 twice. What am I talking about? Yeah. Because my g pawn is pinned. Yeah, correct, of course. So I moved my king away. Give squares. Get squares. Who gets more squares? If that's the game of squares, no, squares are for knights. Not for bishops or rooks. Not for long-range pieces. Then I lost this battle. Both black knights are pretty sturdy, safe. Cannot dislodge them. Okay, I tried to make it up. I played this. I realized that, no, I didn't want to trade my last knight because then I could really get outplayed either in the middle game and surely in the end game with that inferior minor piece, the bishop. But he did this. Oh, there was that. You know, g4, and I really started worrying about this. Ridiculous. But you know what? White's not going to be that much ahead with their queen. And they're going to lose their f4 square. And black's going to practically shut down the white queen. So what do I do? Move a rook? He'll take the other rook. They'll try to double up on the f-file. Maybe a possibility. Even the queen sacrifice. So I did this and I thought I would force the endgame, considered it playable. We probably don't need to go that far back, but I will show you a few more moves to illustrate how white's position started falling apart. So I brought the bishop back. I thought it was clever, but I didn't get the f3 square covered. There was a tactical flurry there. I counted on this move a lot. I thought this is it. His rook on f3 requires protection. And if the rook moves up to f8, there will be this check, rook e8. My opponent, however, is so much deeper. He played this move. And here I am in the same game. Only one pawn for the exchange, but what pawns? A and B. And the knights. This is a very difficult position. And black is actually better here. We played on, but no, well, ultimately, black won the game. Yeah, the bishop there on the. I mean, I don't know, I'm ambiguous about this bishops, like I placed that bishop on e5. It would be a great bishop if I could follow through with some kind of attack on the king side. Why did that never materialize? I'm coming back and I'm thinking, why is that? Why is that that I couldn't get anything going on the king side? I think the answer was that I could not dislodge the black queen from over there. I tried when I played this move h5, but look at the answer, knight f6. If I could only push that queen back, f7, d7, maybe I could get stuff going. But in reality, in this game, never did. So the unusual strange pawn structure. I started really questioning my judgment of this position. So I thought, what is this that I'm doing? I'm wasting one game after another. I'm searching somewhere where no answers can be found. This to me was the real problem with preparation, and it wasn't the only example. There were other opening early middle game positions where I felt like they may be promising, or I thought I could handle them well, but maybe they either weren't promising, or maybe I wasn't handling them well. That's another possibility. In the hands of some other player, maybe. But it's just not for you. Obviously, you think, oh, well, we're talking about some small margins. But, I don't mind preparing this way that I can be a rook up at the end of my prepared line. I just don't know any lines like this. And I don't think that quality opponents would necessarily play along with that. Even Frank Marshall, right? If you go back and think, we know the story, no, it's one of the most celebrated stories that Frank Marshall invented his brilliant pawn sacrifice on the black side of the Rio Lopez. Invented it some time ago after he surprisingly lost a match to Capablanca. At that time, a newcomer, a student coming from Cuba, the United States. And he wanted revenge, of course. And he kept his novelty, that Marshall counterattack, the gambit, for years, until finally he got a chance to use it against Capablanca. And that was a celebrated game. Indeed, it was pretty tactical game. No, well, Marshall's ideas are much improved ever since, of course, but no, the fact is that Capablanca defended, and he won that game as well. But I mean, I don't know, do you really think that people do this? I don't know. I hear it all the time. Suppose there is some kind of big event coming up, like a world championship match. They say, oh, Magnus is going to hide his prep. It's always this prep, so what's this prep thing? I showed you my prep. No, okay, well, I'm no Magnus Carlsen. I never played a world championship match. But no, on my own, you know, I was fairly decent chess player. How come I never had no prep? I had nothing to hide. This is prep, what I showed you. No, okay, well, not very impressive. Makes me think if such things, they really exist. And in this day and age, when every conceivable opening, early middle game position, it gets this complete rundown with computers. I mean, literally, as we speak, you know, there are computers working 24/7, crunching down numbers and all sorts of positions that might be interesting and become critical. And it's done literally by, not even by hundreds, probably by thousands of players. What are the chances that you will hide your novelty for 10 years until finally you use it to defeat Magnus Carlsen? Chances are pretty low. So, anyway, you know that this is rather a sad note. But I mean, it was an interesting game, but the concept of my opponent, he played a very consistent game. I mean, I'm still looking at this, I'm thinking, how come I couldn't save this? I'm up to exchange, but you know, the knights are so great in tactics. Look at this, I cannot even protect my opponent d4. I can't bring the rook back because of the fork on d2. There is the knight c2 fork on the rook and the d4 pawn again. I did this. I was hoping to give up the d4 pawn and give him check from the 7th. He ignored it. How's that? He actually let me defend this pawn. And again, I have the bishop on e5. But so, the black king is going forward. I try to stop it. That was clever. I offered exchange sacrifice. I was thinking I would bring my king to stop the pawns and finally start doing something constructive on the king side. Here I'm down the pawn, but I think my position would greatly improve. He ignores it. After the game, I realized that he probably had crushing move on c5. Now d4 again, there is knight c2 check, so that's the additional attack on the d4 pawn. I'm losing ground. My bishop loses support. This was sort of a, but still, he got the king through. Here and the knight to d5, another fork is threatening. I remember I almost moved my rook away, like farther away, like 1 on 8, away from forks. But if I do the same with the other rook, there are no forks, there's just checkmate. So I ran back, then it goes this. There's another fork. How many of them can happen? No, Rezendavas truly played a very good game. I'm sure there are a lot of players who would not be able to convert black's advantage and, in such fashion. Look at this move. I mean, I was hoping to get like the G or H pawn. He plays this move, gives me a protected passer and maybe a tempo. But the F pawn is not really that effective. It made me think of this rook g8. Maybe it was my decisive mistake. I played this, played that. Was hoping to give up my rook for the a pawn. But it wasn't a1 equals queen, it was this check. That I missed. Now black gets real queen. And this one I cannot save, I'm down a piece. The bigger problem is I'm probably going to get checkmated because that new queen is going to join the hunt. My king. Check, king g3. He played that. Yeah, queen. Queen takes queen g2 mate. Is threatening. Only move. More of these guys are coming. Brilliant finish. I didn't want to see this, the end of this line. His prepared line was as follows. And with the elimination of the rook, queen g2 is going to be mate for real. So, Well, I don't know what to add to this, but so far not so good, right? So you say, well, so you quit, right? No, if I quit, then I wouldn't be talking about splitting this subject into at least two, maybe three parts. So you have to be a little patient and wait until next week. Exactly a week from now, I'll give you part two of preparing like a pro in this particular variation of the English, which some people called poor man's Nimzo Indian.